So let's start on talking about those freed Americans now from North Korea. Obviously, we were all there for that sort of emotional, remarkable moment at Andrews. Can you explain, though, why these folks have not been reunited with their families yet?
First of all, let me just tell you, it was an incredible opportunity to have been a small part of that process and procedure to bring home those Americans who had been in North Korea for far too long, held as prisoner. They're back here in the United States. My understanding, last I heard, is that they had been reunited with their families. These guys are private citizens now. I know that our consular affairs officials were in touch with the families and were assisting with bringing them back in touch with the now freed Americans. That's the latest that I have. But again, they're private citizens now, so I'm not in touch with those gentlemen, but we are thrilled to have them home.
Private citizens who presumably are in close contact with intelligence officials, with folks in your agency about what they saw and heard during their captivity, right? Have you finished debriefing them, or are those conversations continuing?
Well, let me back up first to the plane ride home. We flew home with them. They were on our plane from Pyongyang to Japan. Once we arrived in Japan, they were put on a separate plane. That separate plane had more enhanced medical equipment that could assist them if they should need it. Each one was accompanied, each of those men was accompanied by a medical doctor, a psychiatrist, in which we were able to provide that immediate assistance that's necessary. So some of those conversations presumably started to happen on the plane ride home. Those are things that we are not involved with. We leave that up to the medical experts and the professionals to handle it with the most delicate care, the questions that they would have for those individuals. And now we've provided those men with access to the best medical care in the world, so they are in the process of seeing doctors and getting the kind of assistance that they need. I'm not in the position to speak about exactly what kinds of questions were asked, but I know that the professionals are in charge with that, and I think they'll do an excellent job.
State Department, of course, is involved in the diplomatic efforts ahead of what we'll call the Singapore summit on June 12th. This release is widely being viewed as a good faith effort, a confidence building measure from Kim Jong-un. Do you believe Kim Jong-un can be trusted? Is he an honest broker?
Well, and that's the thing. Secretary Pompeo has said we go into this with our eyes wide open. We are clear-eyed and we are realistic. We have made our concerns and our expectations very well known. Secretary Pompeo did that in his meeting with Kim Jong-un earlier this week, where he spoke about our policy priorities and our expectations. And by the way, I should add that these are not just the United States expectations, but also the Republic of Korea, Japan, and many other countries as well. And that is the complete, verifiable, irreversible denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. That is what we want. That is what we are pushing for. But again, I want to mention we are clear-eyed in our expectations.
What about human rights abuses that have been well documented by the State Department, as you're aware of? Is that going to be on the agenda for these talks?
Look, I'm not going to get ahead of what those conversations are all about.
Should they be on the agenda?
We will see as we go forward. Part of the problem we've seen in the past when the United States has had conversations with North Korea is you throw everything in but the kitchen sink. Important issues. That is something that we highlight here each and every day at the State Department. Human rights abuses. I've discussed this extensively from our podium here at the State Department. We recently put out the human rights report. We are not afraid to call out North Korea for its very well-documented human rights abuses, but we are also having these conversations about the denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. I don't know that we will bring up human rights abuses in that particular meeting. Our priority today is the denuclearization, but I will also add that the humanitarian issues are of great concern to the United States. I just can't say whether or not that will be a part of the conversation.
Does Secretary Pompeo agree with the president that Kim Jong-un is an honorable leader?
Well, I think what the president was saying when he said honorable was that he was honorable in terms of his willingness to sit down and have conversations with the United States. So I think you have to put that comment into the proper context.
He also talked about excellence in the treatment of detainees. Does that give you reason for concern, reason for pause?
Look, we have seen what has happened to detainees in the past. We have seen the horrific condition that Otto Warmbier was brought back home to the United States, and we continue to mourn with Otto Warmbier's family. Fortunately, we've seen the relatively good condition that these three men were brought back into the United States. I don't have all the details about their treatment. We'll learn about that in the coming days. I hope that that will remain private because they're now private citizens, and we're thankful to have them home.
It's not just North Korea, Heather, as you're aware, that is a country holding American citizens. By our count, five are being held in Iran. Didn't pulling out of the Iran nuclear deal just make it harder to get those Americans back home?
look, let's put this blame squarely where it rests, where it deserves to rest, and that is Iran. We have seen Iran for many years, and we know that very well here from the State Department when they took so many of our own people hostage many years ago. Iran continues to take part in destabilizing activities around the world. In its own country, we've been watching over the past few days what it has done in Syria. Iran continues to back the regime of Bashar al-Assad, as Bashar al-Assad, backed by Iran and also Russia, by the way, gasses his own people and kills his own people through chemical attacks. We've seen what they've done in Syria. We've seen what they've done to Israel. Iran continues to take part in those horrible activities. Yes, you are correct. Americans are being held in Iran. We hope we can get them home, too. This administration has had a great deal of success in being able to bring people home. The president did that early on last year with a woman in Egypt. Sadly, we saw what had happened with Otto Warmbier, but nevertheless, we were pleased to have been able to bring him home. And then the Collins family, the family that came out of Afghanistan, who are the Canadians and one
Heather,
was
nobody,
an American. So we've had tremendous success. Yeah.
There's no disagreement that it's Iran's fault for taking these Americans, for capturing these Americans. There's no disagreement on that. What I'm asking you, though, is about the deal-making part of it, as President Trump might put it, the diplomatic part of it, because pulling out of the nuclear deal gave Iran potentially less incentive to release those Americans. So what conversations are you having with the families of those still detained, and is it more difficult now?
Yeah, look, I can tell you those conversations that we have with families are very delicate. They're private conversations. I can assure those families that the United States has not given up on our Americans who are being held anywhere around the world. That is always a priority of ours. And I will be firm and clear and be happy to look any family member in the eye and say that they have not been forgotten. And that is a priority for this administration, as we saw very well with the three men we just brought back home from North Korea.
We're getting tight on time, Heather, but I, of course, want to ask you about the embassy move on Monday. Mm-hmm. This is a big event. This is a big deal. How concerned is the State Department about the possibility of protests, maybe violent ones? What are you doing from a security perspective?
Well, I mean, security is something that we don't discuss publicly. That is something that's always a concern at the State Department. The security of our posts and our embassy personnel and also American citizens all around the world. So we're, of course,
taking
steps.
You're going to have 800 people there on Monday, right? And there is a possibility for
protests.
Well, I want to ask you about I'm not asking about broad security, though, Heather. I am just asking specifically about Monday. With this big event, a lot of dignitaries, a lot of important folks will be there, VIPs, and there is the possibility for violent protests. Are you prepared for that contingent?
Well, look, there's a possibility for violent protests anywhere around the world. And we've certainly seen a lot of violent protests in Israel between the people of Gaza, between Palestinians and Israelis as well. So this is something that if it happens, they certainly have a right to protest. And we support that right of free speech.
Hey there, I'm Chris Hayes from MSNBC. Thanks for watching MSNBC on YouTube. If you want to keep up to date with the videos we're putting out, you can click subscribe just below me or click over on this list to see lots of other great videos.